Jan Boback from Anderson and Boback, here to talk to you today about college, cost, and your children. Now, in the state of Illinois, are you required to pay for your college education of your child? Well, if you're married, as everyone knows, you don't have to pay for that. You could tell your child, you know, good luck. You know, you could help them if you choose to, or you could just wish them well and send them out the door. But in the state of Illinois, if you're divorced, or if you have a child with someone you've never been married to, there's a law in place that will require you to contribute to college education of that child. Now, there's not a formula in place. It's not like child support, and it's not related to child support. Child support ends, as you know, when your child becomes 18 or graduates from high school. This is another statute. It's called 513, and the statute is specifically for the expenses related to a child who's going to attend college. What happens is that the court takes a look at the parent's ability to pay, as well as the child's propensity to go to college and do well in college. And there's also a new provision. It's about the University of Illinois. The cost of going to University of Illinois is like the cap at this point. So no matter where your child's going to go, a court's not likely to order you to pay more than what it would cost for that child to attend the University of Illinois campus. Now, courts will require both parties to pay oftentimes. I've seen it where courts require a child to pay a portion and each parent to pay a portion. I've seen it where the parents pay the same portion, or it could be different. It all depends on the different specific circumstances. If you're remarried and you have someone else helping you contribute to your household expenses, your new spouse's income is not included in that calculation, but your new spouse's income is taken into consideration because that leaves more of your money available to help pay for these college expenses. There's also the potential of student loans. Oftentimes a court would require your child to apply for student loans or apply for grants or scholarships. Again, each case is fact specific, so it depends on the certain circumstances that's relative to each family. There are times when people are in the process of a divorce when they have children, and they may include this in their marital settlement agreement. They may say, when our children become college age, we agree at this point we're each going to pay 50%. Or we're each going to pay a third and the child's going to pay a third with loans and so forth. It's very difficult to advise your clients to enter into this type of agreement because, for one thing, depending on the age of your children, if they're 2 or 3 or 4 or 7 or 8 years old, you can't predict where you're going to be in 10 or 12 years when the child turns 18. And if you enter this agreement when they're younger, it can be enforced. So we don't usually recommend that you enter into an agreement to pay a specific amount when you're entering into a marital settlement agreement when your children are young. When your children become eligible for college, they start applying for college, that's when you file a motion for contribution to college expenses. Now, it's important to note that in order to get your other spouse or the other party to pay, you have to file the motion, and the motion has to be filed before you incur the expenses. As an example, if your child is in freshman year and then your child goes to sophomore year, you file a motion. At that point, you can't ask for what you paid for freshman and sophomore year. It's only going forward. So it's very important that once your child starts the application process and they're thinking of going to college, you open that door, you start having conversations, and you start working out college the best you can. Now, other circumstances that the courts want to take into consideration is how much is available in the child's name. Maybe there's 513 plans. Maybe there's money from a grandparent, or maybe the child has a trust account. Those things are important because if the child has money available for college, they're going to take that into consideration. And of course, that's going to have to be used first. Other things are maybe you have other children that are in college. Maybe one parent has other children that are going to college or has other extraordinary expenses. That's something else that's taken into consideration. So in the marital settlement agreement that we just talked about, if you have an agreement already that you're going to pay a certain amount, keep in mind that's enforceable. Let's say you don't have anything in there, you just reserve it. It's important to file that motion when it comes time so that you can get the college expenses. And you're wondering probably too, well, what does it include? Because when your kids go to college, there's a lot of expenses. And you also want to consider, what if your children are on a break and they're home for the summer? Do I get compensated for who's going to buy their food? So on and so forth. And you think about a particular situation like COVID-19, a lot of college kids came home in March. They weren't able to stay in their dorm room or take advantage of a food plan. So then you wonder, well, what happens with those funds? Were they prepaid? Are they going to be paid? Have they already been paid? Is there reimbursement issues? Or do now I have to pay my spouse for housing the child at their home because of they're no longer on campus? Maybe some college kids aren't going back to campus this year. These are specific instances which are restricted for the time that we're in now, but it's also a consideration. You never know what's going to happen, which is another reason we generally don't talk about college expenses in a marital settlement agreement. Jan Boback from Anderson and Boback, let us know if we can help you through this.